Hey guys, it's your favorite medical channel, Medicosis Perfectionales. We continue on our playlist called Pulmonology. In the previous video, we have discussed the alveolar gas equation. Today, we'll talk about the alveolar arterial gradient, also known as AA gradient. It's like this. D is for gradient, A minus A, O2. This is the alveolar arterial gradient for oxygen. Normally, it's between 5 to 15 millimeters of mercury, although it depends on your age. With that being said, now let's get started. Now, I have some premium videos that are not available on YouTube. Please go to patreon.com/medicosis and click on videos premium, and you'll be able to find those videos. What is the purpose of the alveolar gas equation anyway? As Nietzsche said, he who has a why to live can bear almost anyhow. He who has a Y to alveolar gas equation can bear almost any pressure, no pun intended. And there is no wonder that young people today are just wandering around asking themselves, what is the purpose of life? Because their professors even did not explain to them the purpose of the alveolar gas equation. So what do you expect? I'm joking, of course, because correlation is not the same as causation. Here is the purpose of the alveolar gas equation and the AA gradient. You have two patients. Both of them have a restrictive lung disease. This guy has an extrinsic restrictive lung disease, such as chest wall disease. This guy has an intrinsic restrictive lung disease, such as a pulmonary fibrosis. How to differentiate between them without using the help of a radiologist? You do the ABG, hypoxemia in both of them. You do the oximetry. You have decreased oxygen saturation percentage in both of them. You do the spirometry, decreased lung volume and capacities in both of them, and increase the FEV1-FVC ratio in both of them. So the ABG did not help you, did it? The pulse oximeter could not assist you, could it? And for sure as heck, the spirometer did not do the job either. So what is the solution? It's something called the AA gradient. Where do you get the small a from? From the ABG. Where do you get the big A from? From the alveolar gas equation. You get the gradient. If it's normal, the lung is normal. And you can then blame the chest wall. But if the gradient is increased, the problem is in the lung. If you remember my lecture on pulmonary function tests, I've talked about the limitations of the freaking spirometry. One of them was, spirometry cannot differentiate between intrinsic and extrinsic restrictive lung disease. So what is the solution? You have three solutions, choose one. Flow volume loop, or DLCO, or the AA gradient. You get the P big AO2 from the alveolar gas equation, you measure the P small AO2 from the ABG, you get the subtract the small a from the big A, and you get the gradient. If it's normal, it's extrinsic, because the lung is normal, and if it's abnormal, it's intrinsic. P big AO2 is calculated, P small AO2 is measured. AA gradient, P big AO2 minus P small AO2. P big AO2 equals, as you know from the alveolar gas equation, we'll get the atmospheric pressure. Since your lung is wet and moist, you are not dry as a robot, we subtract water vapor. Then multiply it by the fraction of oxygen, because we're talking about oxygen. Then oxygen and CO2 hate each other, you subtract the CO2 from the oxygen, you get the P big AO2. You get the P small AO2, it's measured in the ABG, and then you get the gradient. So the gradient is P big AO2, which is all of this, minus P small AO2. Normally between 5 and 15. So here's the normal standard for the AA gradient. The big A is around 105 millimeters of mercury, and the small A is around 100. Okay, subtract, and the answer is going to be 5. 5 to 15 is okay. But here's the formula. The AA gradient of oxygen is 0.3 times H. Should be equal or less than that. So, let's say that you are 18 years old. You're 18 years old, 18 times 0.3, let's say just 1/3, equals 6. So, your AA gradient should not exceed 6. If you are 4, you're normal. You're 5, that's normal. 6, okay, still normal. 7, 8, 20, no. You have a problem in the lung. If the patient is 30 years old, his AA gradient should not exceed 9 for the same reason. If you are 90 years old, times 3rd equals 30. Your AA gradient should not exceed 30. So the AA gradient increases with age. And no wonder, because your lung deteriorates as you age. Remember, I've told you, if the AA gradient is normal, your lung is normal. But if your AA gradient is widened, your lung has a problem. And as you grow older, your lung is deteriorating. Therefore, the AA gradient is widening. This is the normal aging effect. There is another stupid formula, which is age over 4 plus 4. Okay, who cares? As you grow older, your P small AO2 decreases, therefore the AA gradient increases, because the AA gradient is P big AO2 minus P small AO2. When you have decreased P small AO2, we call this hypoxemia. When you grow very old, it's normal to have some hypoxemia in your blood. So here's the normal AA gradient, and here's widened AA gradient. Normal, anything outside of the lung. So decreased partial pressure of oxygen in the atmosphere, which is not the lung's fault, hypoventilation, which is not the lung's fault, and hemoglobin defects, which is not the lung's fault. Decreased PiO2, such as high altitude. Hypoventilation, every defect except lung defect. Don't mention lung defect. And I have made another video called Ventilation, Hypoventilation, Hyperventilation. Discussed all of the causes of hypoventilation. Mention all of the causes except those related to the lung. So you could have a problem with the respiratory center in your brain. Most drugs do this. Upper airway problem, acute epiglottitis. Chest wall, such as kyphoscoliosis. Respiration muscles, such as myasthenia gravis. Hemoglobin defects, such as anemia and methemoglobinemia. In anemia, P small AO2 is normal. In methemoglobinemia, also P small AO2 is normal, but there is a difference. In anemia, you have normal P small AO2, normal saturation, but low oxygen content. Why? Because of the decreased hemoglobin amount. Okay, methemoglobinemia, you have normal P small AO2, low SaO2, because less oxygen is binding on the hemoglobin, because it's a methemoglobin, it's not Fe2, it's Fe3, and only Fe2 can bind O2, and you have, of course, low oxygen content. Widened AA gradient, it's in the lung, baby. So VQ mismatch leading to hypoxemia, other causes of hypoxemia related to the lung, and aging, of course, will lead to hypoxemia, as I've said before. That's why your AA gradient widens as you grow older. VQ mismatch. Ventilation defect, perfusion defect, then here we have diffusion defect. Ventilation defect, I cannot ventilate my lung. The VQ ratio will decrease, it may even reach zero. Zero, this will lead to pathological intrapulmonary shunting, not intracardiac, intrapulmonary. Since the gas exchange is defective, P small AO2 is reduced. No kidding. Pulmonary veins are now similar to systemic veins because gas exchange did not happen. That's why the AA gradient is increased, because the P small AO2 is decreased. Example, severe obstructive lung disease such as emphysema, atelectasis such as ARDS and neonatal ARDS. Perfusion defect, you are not perfusing the lung. There is a problem with the blood supply to the lung. VQ ratios increase, it might even reach infinity. Alveolar dead space, this is a dead space physiology because you are ventilating a space with no gas exchange. P small AO2 is reduced and therefore AA gradients increase. Example, pulmonary embolism and fat embolism. Pulmonary embolism is an example of a disease with high D-dimer and a high AA gradient. That's brilliant. Diffusion defect, reduced diffusion through the alveolar capillary membrane, such as fibrosis, pulmonary fibrosis, severe emphysema. Although fibrosis is the more typical example. Cyanotic heart disease, right to left shunt, because only right to left shunt causes cyanosis early on. Okay, so right to left shunt in the heart, so this is intracardiac. Less blood is getting oxygenated because blood is escaping from the right side of the heart to the left, less blood is going to the lung. Reduced P small AO2, of course, increase the AA gradient. That's it. The AA gradient reflects oxygenation, not ventilation. I don't believe you. High altitude and hypoventilation. Okay, those are causes of decreased ventilation. But the AA gradient is normal because oxygenation is okay. If a patient has a VQ mismatch, he or she probably will respond to 100% oxygen. But if a patient has a pathological intrapulmonary shunt, i.e. no ventilation, with wide AA gradient, this patient will not respond to 100% oxygen therapy. 100% oxygen will not cure the shunt, of course. 100% oxygen will not raise his P small AO2. Is there a better option? Yes, PEEP, positive end expiratory pressure, to force the oxygen through the bad alveoli. But here's a caveat. If a patient has a right to left cardiac shunt, such as tetralogy of Fallot, then PEEP can worsen the case. How? Let me explain. Okay, right to left shunt in the heart. Okie dokie, blood is flowing this way. If you give PEEP, you are increasing the pressure in the pulmonary circulation. You are making it harder for blood to go the right way into the lungs from the right side of the heart. All of the blood, or most of the blood now, will shunt to the other side. You're worsening the shunt. You're part of the problem if you introduce PEEP to a patient with a right-to-left cardiac shunt, such as tetralogy of Fallot. You don't want to increase the pressure on the right side. You want to increase the pressure on the left side to decrease the shunt. For instance, that's why this patient will squat. Why squat? To increase the pressure here, to try to shift less blood from right to left and try to get the blood into its normal way into the pulmonary artery. So here are some causes of hypoxia, example of each cause, the AA gradient in each one of them, and the effect of oxygen therapy. I'm talking about 100% oxygen. First, atmospheric causes of hypoxia, such as high altitude. Is the lung normal? Yes. So the AA gradient is normal. How about the response to oxygen? Excellent, because the atmospheric air was less. When you give the patient 100% oxygen, you are solving the problem. Excellent response. 100% effective therapy. Boom! Well done! Let's say the patient has hypoventilation due to a decreased respiratory rate. The patient is breathing instead of 12 breaths per second, he's breathing like, say, 8. Okay, this is low. The AA gradient is normal because the respiratory rate comes from the brainstem. This is very good response to oxygen therapy because it will help with your hypoxia. But it will not cure the hypercapnia. Because if you are breathing 7 breaths per minute, giving you 100% oxygen will not make you breathe 13 breaths per minute. It's not going to happen. But we are just delivering more oxygen into your system. But if the problem is like an obstructive lung disease, of course the AA gradient is going to be prolonged because the problem now is in the lung, such as severe emphysema. Diffusion defect. Pulmonary fibrosis, pulmonary edema. Is the problem in the lung? Yes. AA gradient is abnormal or high. Response to oxygen is very good. You're increasing P big AO2 and therefore increasing P small AO2. This is in the alveoli and this one is in the arterial blood. How about a hemoglobin defect, such as anemia or methemoglobinemia? A gradient is normal. The problem is not in the lung. Response to oxygen, okay. Oxygen therapy will not increase the oxygen saturation on the hemoglobin saturation. It's not going to happen. If it's anemia, your hemoglobin is low. Giving you oxygen is not going to increase your hemoglobin. You have methemoglobinemia. You have ferric instead of ferrous. Giving you oxygen is not going to cure the problem. But it can increase the dissolved oxygen that's not on the hemoglobin, called P small AO2. This little change in the dissolved oxygen can mean the difference between life and death in emergency situations, even though you are not actually correcting the hemoglobin defect. Ischemia, example thrombus, embolus, tissue edema, bad vessel in a peripheral organ, not the lung. Okay, we're not talking about the lung. AA gradient, if the lung is normal, the AA gradient is normal. Response to oxygen when you have a thrombus or an embolus, it's okay. Oxygen therapy will not increase the oxygen saturation. It's not going to increase the hemoglobin saturation. It's not going to remove the clot from the vessel. Okay, but it can increase the dissolved oxygen a little, which is better than nothing. Shunt. If you have intrapulmonary shunt or intracardiac shunt, which means right to left shunt, AA gradient is high if it's intrapulmonary because the problem is in the freaking lung, and the effect of oxygen therapy, no effect. Giving oxygen will not cure the shunt. That's why when we have kids with intracardiac right to left shunt, they go into cardiothoracic surgery. Cellular poisoning such as cyanide or vitamin B1 deficiency, beriberi. AA gradient, the problem is not in the lung. If the lung is normal, AA gradient is normal, no benefit of giving 100% oxygen. 100% oxygen is not going to provide you with enough vitamin B1, and it's not going to cure the cyanide poisoning either. Let me give you some other example. Let's say hemoglobin defect, but in this case, it's carbon monoxide poisoning. AA gradient, the answer is normal. How about effective oxygen therapy? Here, believe it or not, oxygen is very effective. Why? Because this is the hemoglobin on the red blood cell. Two things compete for the same hemoglobin. CO, and oxygen. When you have CO on the hemoglobin, CO has a greater affinity to the hemoglobin than oxygen. The only way to kick this ugly carbon monoxide off the hemoglobin is to provide lots of oxygen to get this son of a out of the hemoglobin. And this is called 100% oxygen. If it's severe, we even use hyperbaric oxygen chamber. Here are some questions for you. Please answer, is the AA gradient normal or is it widened? Okay, answer these questions and you will find the correct answers in the next video. Here's a nice case for you for 4 questions. This is the 16th case. The previous 15 cases are in the previous video in this great pulmonology playlist. Second question, which of the following is most likely to be seen on the X-ray films? Third, what is the expected AA gradient? I'll give you the normal range, which is 5 to 15. So what is the correct answer? Fourth, which of the following is expected to be seen on bronchoalveolar lavage in this patient? The answers to these 4 questions and the previous questions will be found in the next video. That's why you should subscribe. Thank you so much for watching. Please subscribe and join the tribe. Hit the bell to get notified. Follow me on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. I have more than 100 cases on Facebook. And you can go to Patreon to get my premium videos, my notes, my cases, my PDF notes, my audio notes, and even some one-on-one mentorship courses. If you like me to call you over the phone and explain those medical topics to you, I will be more than happy to do so. Thank you so much for watching. As always, be safe, stay happy, study hard. This is Medicosis Perfectionalis, where medicine makes perfect sense.